She's the feminine force worshipped as the goddess of learning. She's a household name. Yet, actually, when you dig deep, how much do we really know about this goddess? She is known as a lost river and seen as a singular goddess, never as part of a couple such as Shiva and Parvati or Lakshmi and Narayan. Today, I'm speaking to Kavita Kane. She's a best-selling author, and we're talking about her new book, Saraswati's Gift. And in this book, Saraswati's Gift, Kane brings out the light to Saraswati's story, the goddess of art, music, and knowledge. And she tells it in the voices of nameless celestials, powerful gods, and lesser mortals. Kavita, a lot of us already know her. She's a best-selling author of 6 novels. She is considered a revolutionary force in Indian writing, mainly because she has brought feminism where it's most needed, in mythology. So first of all, Kavita, with that, a warm welcome to Sipping Thoughts. I'm excited to learn from you. Who is Saraswati?
Hi, Sukriti. So I think first and foremost, I think answering your question, I think the answer lies in the book. So first and foremost, everyone, who is Saraswati? I think please read the book because I think there's so many questions about her, so many things we do not know about her. And I think while writing this book, I think I answered all my questions, and I'm quite sure I must have answered all yours. So I think who is Saraswati? I think Saraswati, of course, she's the goddess of learning and music and art, as you all well know. But Saraswati for me was, I think, it's an inspirational blessing. You can say that it's sort of, you know, if you feel, I feel her around me. And not only because, you know, we are Saraswati. So Saraswati is an extremely familiar goddess with us. But more than that, I think Saraswati, I think she's one... I see her as a woman more than just a goddess. It's like, I think that's what I exactly tried to show in the book, where you look at a goddess beyond being a goddess. What does she actually denote? And I think we really don't see what all she symbolizes. We just see her as that goddess to sort of pray to before our exams. You know, she's the goddess of learning. The Saraswati Puja. I mean, that's about it. I mean, these are the only 2 occasions, of course, the exam time and the puja per se. Where we actually sort of remember her and revere her. But Saraswati, I think, actually, we sort of should see her and feel her in our daily lives, because I think she is part of our journey of discovery, our part of self-education, self-enlightenment. I think all that part, I think Saraswati is always there in you. This whole, let's say, the small thing, the child's curiosity to learn more, a man's curiosity to learn more, I think that is Saraswati, you know, this whole thing of yearning for knowledge, the thirst for the unknown, you know, this whole, the mental acuity, the capability of the human mental acuity to where they want to, the whole curiosity aspect, the seeking knowledge, seeking information, seeking education. And I think it's a daily thing. I mean, what we are doing in our daily life, what we are doing every day, you want to know things. It's an attitude, you know. So Saraswati, I think, becomes, it's a part of your personality where you want to know more than what you are. You know, what
very
you are.
Well, very well said.
Because what is around you, you know, this entire sensitivity or the empathy towards the surroundings, towards the world around you, the search within. I think all this is the continuous process, which I think is personified by Saraswati. You know, she is sort of even... I wouldn't even say personified. I think personified in our mind, but I think that is the abstract concept of Saraswati.
Now let's talk about, why did you want to write about such a well-known personality? Because all of your other 6 books are about lesser-known women in Indian mythology. So what was it about her that fascinated you so much?
Yes, as I said earlier, I think she's an extremely familiar goddess. We know about her. We revere her, we worship her. But... we don't know anything about her. I mean, unlike Parvati or Durga or Lakshmi, who are more seen everywhere, who are more visible goddesses in a culture and in a, let's say, in a social life, I think Saraswati has been, unfortunately, she has been sidelined. You know, she has been sort of marginalized as a, and we really don't know her. That's what Asa said. She's one goddess who is there in every step of our way, and we really ignore her. We don't even realize that she is there. So I think Saraswati, I mean, when I'm talking about the other six novels and the other six characters, if they were lesser known characters, I think Saraswati is a relatively known goddess, but a lesser known goddess in the sense we don't know much about her. In fact, it sort of stemmed from my own ignorance that for a very, very long time, I think till the age of 12 or 13, I didn't know she was Brahma's wife. So I think...
I didn't know that either.
Yeah, so I didn't know that. I saw some TV serial and I said, oh, she was married and she had Brahma was... You know, that entire trigger started. Oh my, she was married. So all this time, I always visualized her as this solitary goddess, which you always see her. We never see her as a couple. So I think that particular incident, it sort of showed my ignorance, and I said, okay, if I can be ignorant, there might be many like that. So when I decided to write, there was only one goddess I really wanted to write about, and it was Saraswati. Exactly for this reason, because I think we really don't know much about her, which we should, because I think she is such a beautiful, her entire concept is so beautiful, and more than anything, I think extremely close and familiar if you wish it to be so, because I think she's there. She's there not only in our schools and our colleges and during our supposed educating years where we are learning or in the academia, but I think in our daily lives. I mean, it is like she's the constant teacher.
So no, very nicely said.
So, I think.
But let's talk about you, because when any woman writes about anything that's about women or about strong women, they're labeled as feminists. Do you feel that you are a feminist writer?
I'm definitely a feminist and I'm definitely a writer. So yes, I am a feminist writer. Because I think the whole feminism word has got it's been so badly abused and misused, you know, this whole, and I think there's a lot of misconceptions about, I'm not going to clarify that, because I think to each his own. If they want to think, if people are deciding to be ignorant about the word feminism, I think it's their loss. But feminist writer, I'll tell you how it actually comes about, because I think, like in real life, women are largely ignored. I think even in our literature, women should write about women. Personally, I believe, because women, the entire women's point of view is never really considered. You know, it's always the man, the man's world. His feelings, his reactions, is everything about the men. The women are always in the periphery. She happens to be his wife. She happens to be his daughter. She happens to be his lover, you know. So usually the men protagonists have completely dominated literature in a very large way for a very large time. So when we're talking about feminist writing here, it's because we are talking about issues. You know, we are not even talking about women. We are not talking about the issues, their problems, their mistakes, their follies, their desires. I mean, everything about women. Women, a woman as a person, as an individual. Here we are not talking about women against men or something. It's talking about women as an individual. So I think she should be portrayed also, because for the simple, and especially when I'm talking about the epics here, we see even the epics, we see largely in completely in the male's point of view. We think of the first thing when we talk about the Ramayana and the Mahabharata, we think of Ram, Krishna, Ravan, Duryodhan, Karna. You know, you remember the first images of the men. Though Sita and Draupadi are also there. So, and now you have Sita and Draupadi again are the protagonist. But what about the other women in the epics? So, you know, these sort of things, they are completely ignored. Their stories have not been told, or they have been largely overlooked. So I think when we are talking about issues about women and the world they live in, I think that needs to be in display.
Now coming back to this question, this genre that is emerging, mythological fiction, whatever you might call it, mm-hmm. How much is real and how much is fiction? Because there's a lot of confusion in terms of how do the writers, because they try to get into the mind or putting together the situations. So how much research goes into this? So
there's a lot of research, but what we are talking about fact and fiction. I think since my characters are usually minor characters, and it's not much about them. It is actually a dramatization of the event or that episode and how it would have been. In the sense, the whole thing is dramatized and how she would have reacted. Let's say an Ahilya or a Saraswati. I mean, see, if you let's talk about this book. Saraswati, let's say, there are different stories about her. And how would it have been? I tried to, while doing the research, I tried to link these assorted stories, you know, because they all, one story which is there in the Ramayana changes in the Mahabharata and the Purans is completely different. So there is a lot of chronological gaps also here. So sort of linking the dots, joining the dots and creating a sort of a flow, a sort of a narrative and making a story. So that's how usually the framework of my of that character and the book goes. So I think these, whether it was Ahilya, I think Saraswati was relatively easy because there were certain episodes which were there and were sort of interlinked it. And then telling the story by, I think then the author sort of has to balance between the fact and the fiction. Because since they are borrowed characters, I can completely cannot create something which is against the collective imagination. So Saraswati, there is a certain image you have of Saraswati, you have a certain image of Menaka, you have a certain image of Ahilya, any other character, Urmila, I've written. So I try to stick to the original, so what this original character is, and then try to sort of expand. So that is the skeleton, and I try to flesh it with all the emotions and the drama and the action. So I think that is the fiction part. But yes, the skeleton is definitely the fact. So that is the balance. You can say that. So the bones and the other parts.
Now let's talk about this one, because this is one of the ones that I was Googling, the creation of Saraswati. How was she actually come into being? In your version, Brahma has created her. Many versions, many truths. Some say she's the daughter of Shiva. Certain sects say that she was born from the left part of Vishnu in his eternal sleep. So how does it come about? Because there are so many versions. And which one do we know is actually the fact and which one is the fiction?
No, actually, I think, as I said, these stories have not to be taken literally. I think there's a lot of depth. There's a very strong allegorical or a metaphorical interpretation to each of these stories. So I think peeling those layers is very important. They are not. So I decided on the Brahma Saraswati because I think if he was a creator and she is his creation, and both represent. Again, there is this thing about creation and creativity. So, it's a Greek word, but yes, if she is his muse, and that's how the love or the romance between Brahma and Saraswati, I think I've started from there, where she is his inspiration. She is his vision, because she helped him create the world. He created the world, she was the soul of the world. There was a reason for that, you know, because if he's the mind, she is the reason. You know, that whole thing of the mind and reasoning, that I think that is the relationship between, I think, Brahma and Saraswati. If she is the creation, she is the creativity. If he is the mind, she is the reason. So I think when he created the world, there has to be a reason for behind every creation. And I think that is how their journey starts. So I sort of selected this piece where she is created by him, because I think that was the most appropriate, more logical other version which I liked rather. And because I think it's such a beautiful symbiotic relationship which they have, because one can't do without the other. It's not only about Brahma and Saraswati, it's about Saraswati and her followers, you know. It's a relationship, it's an engagement of the mind, it's an engaged marriage of the minds. They have to be together. Creation and creativity has to be together. So that is why it's not about she being created from a particular part of the body, because again, there's a different story behind it. I literally showed her that she came from his mind. So.
But let's talk about that, because certain parts of him, and because we will talk about obsessive love also, because you delve into love also a lot, and that, you know, certain stories, especially of Brahma, that the reason he grew four heads was that so he could see Saraswati from all angles. So let's delve into the concept of love, because Is it a quiver of an arrow? Is it so obsessive? Is it so over encompasses? What is love?
For him?
For him Brahma. And for her. Because they're so very different.
Yes, because for him, it is exactly what you describe, everything what you describe. But for her, I think that is exactly, it becomes a paradox, it's sort of an irony that he creates his perfect woman, but she's more into the mind than the heart. So she does not reciprocate for the simple reason that she is a woman of the mind. She's not a woman of the heart. So there, the clash, the conflict starts, where she doesn't believe in love. She doesn't believe in the emotion of love. And she believes that love is unreasonable. She sees it all around her. She accepts it, acknowledges, but she doesn't want it in her life because she is of a certain, she's made in a certain way. And he has created her. So it is like, it's like he created this woman and who does not respond to his love. So I think that is how the initial conflict actually starts. And so I think when you see these two characters, for them, love is two completely opposite things. For him, it is as necessary as thinking, you know, because for him, if he's thinking, love is also important. For her, it is a distraction. It's a burden. It's a responsibility, which he doesn't want to take. So I think they're two highly individualistic people again, where having completely an opposite way of thinking or reacting to that particular emotion. And I think that's how their romance starts, on a very, very rocky, turbulent way. And which I think through their life, I think it is like that. The relationship is a very stormy relationship. Because again, it sort of represents always the clash between the heart and the mind. You know, it's always there, even in our lives. I mean, any decision we take or anything we do, it's always the clash between the emotions and the mind, with the emotion and reasoning. So I think Brahma and Saraswati again represent that, where Brahma is less of a thinking man than she. You know, she is completely cerebral, completely symbolizes intelligence, and he, since he is the creator, he has created an emotion called love also. So since he becomes a victim of that particular emotion which he created.
Now let's talk about this, because I think through Saraswati, you also take us through a lot of questions that women are grappling with today, especially what is so important in a woman's life to be a wife and a mother. And you also give us the glimpse of the whole question of marriage and whether it is limiting or expanding. And I'd like to get your thoughts on that, because Saraswati takes us through that beautifully. And, you know, because she's also questioning this.
I think when I was grappling this particular issue about marriage and motherhood, which are the, let's say, the pillars of the social pillars which identifies women, you know, a woman has to get married and then she has to be a mother, this whole concept, her definition of as a wife and a mother. And it's being questioned by Saraswati. And I think the question which you asked me is actually, I think I tried to explain it in that conversation she has with Parvati. Because Parvati is the other side, you know, she's the mother, she's the wife, and Saraswati doesn't wish to follow that particular path. And the conversation between the two. And here, I think in the conversation, what I was trying to say was, nothing is good or bad, or nothing is acceptable or unacceptable. It is up. It is leave the choice to the woman, to that particular person. And I think here, again, Saraswati's nature comes forth, where Saraswati, when you are, Saraswati means the essence of the self.
You ask me
the first question, yeah. You ask me who is Saraswati. Saraswati is the essence of the self. You have to love yourself, you have to know yourself, you have to realize yourself. Only then can you respond and react to the world, to people, to humans, to relationships. That is what Saraswati actually is. You know, I mean, literally, of course, she means, Sara means water, and Swati is one who possesses. But here I'm talking about, so she is the essence of the self. So that is what she's actually trying to say, that a woman is a woman first. Then she becomes a daughter, then she becomes a wife, then she becomes a mother. So whatever she is, of course, she's born a daughter. So there again, her choice is limiting. But she has a choice to become a wife. She has a choice to become a mother. Leave that choice and the decision to that particular girl or that woman. That is what she's sort of endorsing. And Parvati is the other. Parvati and Lakshmi are giving the other side of the argument. So I think because they are different people, they are different women in the world. everyone doesn't wish for marriage and motherhood or whatever. Also, some people wish for marriage and no, not motherhood. Some people wish for just motherhood and not marriage. I mean, there are so many. So why are you sort of straitjacketing them into, sort of a social mold, you know, that society sort of puts that pressure on them. Not only society, it's family also. So this whole, so I think here she's questioning the entire parental control, the familial control or the social control on a woman's definition of what she wants to be. So whether she wants to be single, whether she wants to be in love, whether she wants to marry, whether she wants to have a child, whether she wants to pursue her career, whether no, she doesn't want to pursue her career, she wants to be at home and be a homemaker, whatever, leave that decision to her. So I think there again, it boils down to her personality and the definition of Saraswati, which actually means a sense of the self. So I think if you are true to your sense, if you're true to that, I think that defines you completely.
But one of the beautiful things about the book, because you see the goddess of learning repeatedly challenging the authority of Brahma and the other gods, and you actually show her that she has a mind of her own. What gave her such confidence and clarity? Because she was created by Brahma.
I think he fell in love with her mind. I think that is the whole thing. I mean, she has been created. He creates his perfect woman who has a he falls for her mind. She's his inspiration, and she's a woman. She falls for an intelligent, clever, independent woman whom he has created. Now, it's that again.
She challenges him constantly.
Yes, because it's very easy. It's like let's talk in layman's term. If a man falls, you know, usually they do fall like an intelligent, smart, intelligent woman. Yes, but after the initial romantic interest, do they survive? Does that, would it survive a marriage? You know, this whole thing, it happens in our lives also. So you see a lot of marriages where, and then they say, no, this woman has too much opinion. You know, it's obviously it was going to break up because she's too loud and she really was. So I think this whole question of woman being loud, woman voicing opinions, woman, she's no-nonsense sort of woman. You know, this whole definition actually is what Saraswati is in, let's say, in the book which I have said, because she will not, whether it's Vishnu, whether it's Shiva, whether it's her own husband. I think the most of the problems, clashes she has, or the arguments she has is with her husband, is because of that. And then because if you have given her a mind, she is going to use it. She is, you have made her the goddess of learning, of music and art, and she's earned it. I've shown her that it's not a privilege which is given to her, she actually earns. In through the book, she earns. She becomes how she gets involved in music, how she gets involved in the arts. You know, it's so. If you have made such a woman as your wife, then you better be brave enough to tackle her. Be brave enough. You should be competent enough yourself to tackle her. Now, the whole thing is, the onus is not on her. The onus is on you. So on the man here, where because in the end, it's not about the intelligence or let's say. It's not a gender issue at all here. That is what I was trying to say. When it's two minds arguing, it could be any, there may be two intelligent minds. It doesn't have to be a man and a woman. The definition changed the moment it's a man and a woman. The gender issue should not be there, but the gender issue comes because you're trying to say, oh, womanhood against mankind. No, it is not like that. I don't think so. Because they're two intelligent minds or two emotional minds when they clash. They're two minds. They're two hearts, they are two people, you know, they are individuals who are in a relationship. So I think here, when she is sort of questioning these men's decisions, because there is a certain arrogance, there is a certain taken for granted attitude where, you know, oh, she's an intelligent person, but she's not supposed to voice, she's not supposed to be seen, she's not supposed to be heard. When she is heard, the sound is not very pleasant to them.
No, your book is beautiful.
I think that whole fear of being, what if she overperforms? You know, this whole fear of they not performing as good as her. I think as a woman, you know, that's what I'm trying to say. I think that is the reason why this whole question, the modern question arises, where are they uncomfortable with a confident man should not be uncomfortable with an intelligent or a smart woman. No, he would not be. So I think it all stems from that. But whether he's confident, whether that fear of she overperforming is there, you know, all that. I think these are the questions which actually...
Yeah, no. So if I summarize your book, it tells an extraordinary story of a goddess who mm-hmm. challenges the notions of marriage, of motherhood. She refuses to be reduced to a concert of a god. She wants her own identity. But what inspiration can young readers take away from this book? And how much do you feel that mythology plays a role in shaping our minds?
Completely, I think so. I mean, in the sense, very much so. Because these are the stories which you hear from childhood. I mean, I'm quite sure most of us have heard either from our grandparents or from books. So it's very important what are the stories being told to you. So if you have this image, I think we have had very extreme and very simple embodiments of women. I'm talking about women representation here. You know, because woman is either a devi or a devil. You know, it's either Sita or Surpanakha. You know, that whole extreme. We never see the grace of a woman at all in the story, that or the strength or her angst of a woman. All these, the grace are never shown. So I think the stories, when they are being told, when I try to tell this, we say very same story, I try to see the woman's perspective. I try to see if she is the protagonist, and if she's given a chance to tell a story, how would she tell it? So I think coming back to your question is, of course, it's shaped because we have mythified our epics in a certain way. We need to demythify it by using the same genre. You know, if we've been told by us. So I think most of the stories, most especially the women, have become victims of patriarchy. Because patriarchy is there. So it was there. It was in the entire world, not only in our country. It's been there all over the world. It's there. It's going to be there. But how do you react to it? That is very important. How does each, every woman react to this patriarchy? That, I think, gives or defines her strength, her strength to fight, her strength to... it is not about winning or losing. It's a question of she fighting.
This and she says system. She fights without having to raise any weapons.
Yes, yeah, because exactly. How only weapon are her words and her tongue.
Yes.
So I think Saraswati is that because she herself is a goddess in a patriarchal world, you know. I mean, it's a completely male-dominated. But again, this whole thing of, I think I would not say the balance is there. When there's a three-day, there's a three-devi. I mean, I think that is so important. And here again, her argument is that they are just not the consorts of, they are not three-devis because they're the consorts of the three-devi. They have an identity. They have a reason to be there. They are the feminine source, if they are the feminine strength, if they are the feminine energy, it is needed to balance out everything in the world. If there is a male, there has to be a female. So when there are two species, when it's been created, man and a woman, so give the woman that the same opportunity, the same chances, the same situation which is given to a man. It's not a man being like a woman, or a woman like being like a man. It is just being given the same opportunity. So that is what exactly Saraswati, you're talking about feminism. Feminism is exactly that. It's not, a woman doesn't want to be like a man. Here we are trying to say, we are living in the same world, give us the same chances which you give to a man. The same situation, the same justice, the same rules which apply. If there are rules, let them be fairly.
But it's so true, because we'll pray to Saraswati, we'll pray to Lakshmi, we'll pray to all of them, because when we want knowledge or we want wealth,
yes.
But when we see the same thing in our wives, we want our daughters, we don't want them to be more educated than their husbands. We still are intimidated by very strong, educated women.
Definitely, because I think I have tried to, this is a sort of a running thread in the book, and I think it's sort of specifically dealt with in the chapter about the Kumbhakarna Ravan, where, you know, the three brothers come for the blessing and the sister is not there. Why is the sister not there? You know, this whole concept. No, of course, this is, again, as you talk about, this is fiction. This is a hypothetical situation. Why was Surpanakha not given? Because she was not educated in the first place. You know, that higher education was easier for these three boys. So there Saraswati sort of challenges the three men and her husband that this is the scenario where since she was not educated herself, she cannot come for the boon. So this, where you are depriving a woman of the first step, on the very first step, that you are not giving her the education. You know, so I think this is very simple. I think this is a means of subjugation, or this by suppressing. It happens very simply by denying you certain rights. And this has been done through the centuries, through the years. And I think Saraswati, when the goddess talks about it, I think what I would like to say is that she herself becomes, she herself had to suffer that. Or she saw people suffering that. So that's what I think that whole line when she says that, you know, they have made us into goddesses. But are these goddesses there in their own home? In the sense, okay, do you see this part of goddesses in your wife, in your sister, in your daughter? It's so important. Or in your daughter-in-law. When you're praying, you're worshipping a goddess, it's more important for a man to translate that his faith or that feeling into his family, into his everyday life. The respect for a woman is not just worshipping a woman. What is more important than worship is respect. So I think it comes down to that.
So is there a specific message that you're trying to do, or a specific type of change that you're trying to bring about with your books?
I hope there is a change, because I think, as I said, I mean, I'll have to repeat whatever I just said now, because I think definitely there's a message. I think girls have to think themselves as individuals, not just as, you know, as a woman or as in a man's world. No, it's beyond that. I think as strong individual, I think something what Saraswati says, as I said earlier, it's a sense of the self. You have to self-realize. You have to self-rationalize. You have to say, you have to know yourself. You have to love yourself. I think that is so, it's so easy to say, for me to say this, but it's very difficult. There, this whole thing of shame and suppression and a certain discrimination, you live through discrimination. I think it is so sort of, we sort of, women, girls unconsciously absorb it right from childhood. So there again, you are creating a completely unequal world. It starts from there. So I think here the message is, I think because girls do have to, here I'm talking about women, I'm talking about girls, because really have to, I mean, they're growing here, they have to struggle, they have to fight. So my only message is fight. Fight back. If this is the system, you have to fight back, because this is not a world for where you can sit back and take it. No, I don't think so. I think it's a continuous battle, and I think we are strong. We are born strong. I think we have proved scientifically that even the girl fetus is stronger than the male fetus. So I think let's not underestimate ourselves. I think the message is this, that yes, I think we are strong. Let's be strong. And I think just keep on fighting. Because it is a fight. It is a battle, I think, in every day. It's an everyday life. It's been there for years. It's going to be there for years. But as I said, the will should not be broken. I think that is the message that you have to. I mean, these stories, when you hear about women, we have such interesting women in our epics and in our texts. And if they could live their lives, so can we.
Well said, well said. Now, who are you working on next? Everybody is dying to know. What's the next character that you're developing?
Which everyone knows that I usually do not reveal the character. Yes, but then, yes, she's again like a highly misunderstood woman. Not only misunderstood, she's highly, completely ignored, I think, so in the, if you see in the entire narrative. So I think I sort of picked her out. I hope people recognize her. So it starts from there. She's been ignored so badly. So yes.
So any closing thoughts as we end for today?
Closing thought? Same thing, I think what I'm trying to say is this. I hope these books are the way I think, honestly. I'm being very, very brutally frank here, is the way I think, unapologetically. And what is there in the book is what I want to say. And I hope you agree to what I have to say. And you like what I write. And therefore, if you like what I write, then please read more of my books. Because in the sense, I think it sort of reverts to your question that, is there a message? I think a writer is not you cannot insulate a writer from the society he lives in. So if in any way I can make, even if it's a make believe, it's a make believe world, I think in a better way, then I think I've done my little bit. I think that's what
it's a beautiful book. I think the reason I loved it, because when you read it, you see that these are all the issues today as women we are grappling with. So you try to get a perspective, and you get a perspective about that issues maybe from a different way. So it was very, very interesting.
Yeah, because there's so many
issues. Are so modern.
There are so many issues. Yeah. I mean, when you're talking, I think again, I go back to your question about women writing about women, because I think we are not. I think women are completely ignored. Not only ignored, I think it's not considered a topic worth writing about. You know, these are issues which are there. Yes, like the woman herself, her issues are completely neglected, overlooked, and I think it's almost apathetic the way we look at it. They're not even recognized, acknowledged. There is a certain apathy about the whole reaction. So I think if I can tackle some issues which I have in this book through the goddess, because I think the most important part about this book was, if she is the goddess of learning and knowledge, she has given you knowledge. What do you mean by knowledge? You know, knowledge is just not education and information. Is that wisdom which comes? Has that been instilled? Has that been imparted? And I think it's sort of reflects on both men and women. How much of it have you sort of imbibed it? So that is the question she has to the world. And like a goddess, I mean, Saraswati, always remember, she's also the river. So if the river left us, so one day if Saraswati abandons us, what will happen to the world? So, sort of a horrible, horrible, horrible world we'll live in if suddenly we're deprived of all our information and of knowledge and of our brains. If you don't have intellect, what will happen to our world?
Thank you so much. That was really nice and a really amazing book. Thank you for being with us today on Sipping Thoughts.
Thank you. Let me just show this book at least. Yes, and you say yes, it is matching. The whole thing is in perfect coordination, which is happened to be coincidental. So thank you, and I love writing the book, and I'm so happy that you love reading the book. So I hope that is the universal response, and do let me know the feedback, and because I think that is so important for the author. Thank you again.
Thank you so much.